sweet of rest. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus. 'Tis a hand of hands to me, and it lifts me up to glory. For it lifts me up to Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise and to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge beneath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to see, just Him, Jesus, simply take life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him.
Hey, how's it going?
Trust Him
more.
Good morning. Would you please stand and sing with us?
Shout, praise the Lord. When the King of King returns, King of King returns. Oh, how I want to be in that number. When the King of Kings returns,
I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna shout, shout, shout. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. When those gates are open, and at the marriage of the Lamb, and at the marriage of the Lamb, I want to be in that number. At the marriage of the Lamb,
I'm gonna sing, sing, sing. I'm gonna shout, shout, shout. I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, praise the Lord. When those gates are open wide, I'll be sitting by Jesus' side. God alone, you have this one, and with our light is God alone, just us. Oh, how I want to be in that number, when our light is God alone.
I'm going to sing.
I'm going to sing, 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 sing.
I'm going to shout, shout, shout. I'm going to sing, I'm going to shout, praise the Lord. When those gates are open wide, I'm going to sit by Jesus' side.
I'm going to sing,
I'm going to shout, praise the Lord.
Greet one another with this question. We're talking about unity today. So share one thing you think makes for a united, happy family or church. And get each other's names, and then you can be seated for the announcements.
Good morning to all of you. Well, just to let you know, Bob and I were over on the other side of the state, actually, and Jody and Wynn and Carl and Barb and several of us over there for a conference this week. Man, what a blessing. God is working on our state, and we're going to see some great things happen in the days ahead here. So it was a real blessing. Thanks for praying for us on that. God's on the move this week around here, too. So right after second service today, there's the Intergenerational Life Group. If you are looking for a fun experience with people of all ages and the Word of God, that is a great time. So join us after the second service. Youth group meets tomorrow night at 6 o'clock here. And so if you've got teenagers in that category, make sure that they hear about that and become a part of that. This Friday, we've got revival prayer happening right here in this room, okay? So we are hosting for the whole city 12 hours of revival prayer from noon to midnight. You're welcome to come at any time, leave when you have to, but expect the presence of God to be here and expect to be changed by His presence. So when we spend time in His presence seeking His face, He promises that He will come and meet with us. And so that's here Friday night or Friday afternoon, noon to midnight, and expect great things from God. Lastly, next Sunday, we got a fellowship luncheon on the 24th. And just in case you're trying to decide, it's going to be smoked turkey, mashed potatoes and gravy, salad, green beans, all this kind of good stuff, okay? So on Palm Sunday, that's correct. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. So come and plan to celebrate the coming of the Lord on next Sunday. All right, so I'm going to turn it over to Andrew this morning, who's going to bring to our attention something that we've talked about a month or two ago.
Okay, so a couple months ago, I did a sermon, and I was studying Jesus, and we were surprised. One of the things we learned from that was that Jesus was interested in going from town to town to preach the gospel of the kingdom of heaven, and He was not going from town to town to heal, though He did lots of healing, and the healing is what gathered the crowds, not so much the teaching. And so the one application from that sermon was that we all need to talk about the kingdom of heaven more than we are. And I didn't really have any ideas on how to do that better. And then that later that week, Jesse and I were talking in staff meeting, and his t-shirts that he wears with, one of them says Jesus in a fish is the way or something like that. He said that produces a lot of conversation. So I thought, oh, that's an easy way to, and something to try. Oh, he's wearing it today. That's wonderful. So over the last couple weeks or couple months now, I've been getting t-shirt ideas from you all, and I'm going to go through what we have so far, and then there'll be a table in the back between the services, and you'll see the t-shirt design and a number next to it, and there'll be a little basket there, and you'll write, there'll be instructions there, but you'll get to vote for three t-shirts, and whichever three get the most votes after the two services we'll make, and then hopefully you'll wear them. Hopefully they'll produce conversations about God. So I'm going to explain those t-shirts right now. I'll kind of run through them quickly, but then if you want to look at them in more detail, there'll be pictures out there. The first one, this is an idea from Bob. He just wanted the words, "His will is being done." So I made a couple. By the way, I use the same font just for simplicity for a lot of these. If you ever have ideas, like you're like, I really like number one, but I think we could change it in this way, just write that down. We're just figuring this out together. So this was one of Bob's ideas. His will is being done. The next one is one that I took from the title from an album of a song that I like, and it's basically the idea of the potter and the clay, but it's with origami, and so it's just a shirt that says, "I'm origami," and the "I am" is capitalized because it's the kind of the being that is folding us into different shapes is the great I am, so that's what that explains. These shirts are meant to cause people to wonder, like, hey, what is your shirt about, and then we can explain. Go ahead, keep going forward, not backwards. Can you go to they should be in order. Go to number four. This one is a picture that Bob now has in his office. So underneath is each book of the Bible, each chapter, so however many chapters there are, and the length of it is those little white things. So you'll see Psalm 119 is that long one there. And
every time, so there's 63,779 lines in that picture. Every time there's a cross-reference from one book to another, a line is drawn. And the longer the line, the different the color. So it creates a rainbow. But what you're looking at is like a, it's a science thing. It's the number of cross-references in the Bible and the books between which chapters. And so it also kind of reclaims the rainbow. So it's not, in our culture, it means something totally different than God's promises are fulfilled. And I just thought it was cool that it's like people would see a rainbow, but then they see the number and they might ask, what is that about? And you can talk about the faithfulness of God to fulfill his promises. Okay. This one, it was an idea from Kathy McMorris Rogers. So I guess Spokane means children of the sun in the original language. And so she said, can we somehow tie that to the Bible? So this is just a Spokane shirt on the front. And right, there's nothing biblical about that. And then on the back, I put the next one, which is a verse that refers to the Son of Righteousness. It says, but for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings. So I think it would be a way for people to recognize, oh, yeah, you're from Spokane, but then it has a spiritual significance on the back. Go to the next one. This one comes from the book of Jeremiah. And again, if you want, if I didn't put the verse for this one on the back of the shirt, though I could, if we feel like that would be helpful. It comes from also a book by Eugene Peterson, but in the verse, which is hidden somewhere on there, it says Jeremiah 12:5. The verse is, Jeremiah is basically complaining about what he's been called to do, and God says, if you can't run with men, how do you expect to contend with horses? And so he's basically saying, I have plans for you that are much more difficult than what you're going through. And so anyway, the line is run with the horses, and that's the image that I've found and put together. The next one just says pray. I think this was another of Kathy's idea. One of them has praying hands with it, and one of them is just the word. It's easy to change the colors and the fonts. Again, so if you're like, I don't want a bright t-shirt, or if you want a bright t-shirt, we can choose different colors. So just put those comments in there. The next one is a reworking of the shirt that Jesse's wearing right now. Go ahead to the next one. So, yeah, it's just the same exact thing as his t-shirt. It says Jesus in a fish, and it says the way. I just made it a little, what I call less clip-arty. It's not just white and black. It's a little more there. Does anybody know what kind of fish that is? It's a tuna. Do they have those in the Sea of Galilee, or does that sound like no way? Maybe I should change that fish then. Figure out what kind of fish they have there. I don't know. It's just a fish. Maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe write that down if you want that in a different thing. This one was from Grace. She wanted the line, need a lifeguard, Jesus walks on water. And I think I did two of those same ones. Go to the next one. I think it's the same. Yeah, it's just the same wording, but in a different logo. There's a couple more. Oh, this is another one from Grace. The next one. She said, Jesus takes the L out of slaves, which turns it into saves. And so I made Jesus saves darker than the other part. But that's just another witty logo. The next one is, on the front it would say this. And then on the back it's a verse from Isaiah 61:3, which says, they'll be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. And then the last few here are ones that people in the congregation either drew or colored or submitted. So this one says, sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. These were from Rick. He colored that one, and then he drew that cross. And then these other ones, you'll see them out there on the table. They're bigger than what they look like here, but there's a front and a back. So you have to take the picture and look at the back, because there's a front to the shirt and a back to the shirt. But these are ones that Audrea did, and they have, right now they're just in pencil. She just drew them, but they have on the side like a little key of, this is what the colors should be. The stars should be this color. And so you can look at those. So all of those have, I think that's all of the shirts. Yeah, all of those have little numbers next to them. And so if you want, again, you want vote for three of your, what you would actually wear. And then we'll make them up. And whatever they cost, if it's like $500 for 100 shirts, that seems like a lot, $200 for 100 shirts, then whatever the cost is, I'll just divide that by the number of shirts. And so no one's making any money here. If it costs $15 to make a shirt, that's how much it'll cost to get it, so we can just pay for it ourselves. We don't have to make a new budget item in the church or anything like that. Okay, that's it. Let's pray over these shirts and continue the process that they might actually result in conversations about God more than just more than what I've been talking about him. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we submit this all to you as we do with every area of our lives, Lord. We've hopefully been led by your spirit to identify a need to grow in, and that was talking more about you, Lord, having greater courage to speak about you with everyone we come in contact with. And we're hoping that these t-shirts would perhaps produce more conversation or at least help people to identify that we are Christian, Lord, that we believe in Christ Jesus and all that that entails. So continue as we vote on these things and put these shirts together, Lord, continue to guide those processes. And yeah, that's it, Lord. We love you and we offer this hopefully for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, we're going to sing some more. Would you please stand?
Mysterious and unknown.
Be seated for communion.
In the 12th chapter of Revelation, where the curtains pulled back a little bit and we get to see
a spiritual battle. And it's for our souls. Then war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels, they fought against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. And then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and our sisters, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. And they triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Therefore, rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell on earth. Woe to the earth and to the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He's filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short." That describes the world today. And yet God says he's already a defeated foe. He's been defeated by the blood of Jesus Christ, and he will be defeated by the word of your testimony. And the word of your testimony is when today you take these elements, you are saying, "I declare Christ Lord of my life, Lord over this earth, crazy as it is. I declare Christ as Lord." That's what we do when we celebrate communion. We're in the battle. We're going to see that today. Boy, are we in the battle. But Jesus says, don't be afraid. Oh, he's angry. Satan's angry. He's prowling all over the earth. He's doing his darndest to destroy the kingdom of God. But the people of God overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Father, this morning as we take these elements, we declare Jesus is Lord. We declare the blood of Christ is more powerful than any sin we have or will ever commit. We declare to this world that you are great. You are God. You're triumphant. You have purchased from every tribe and tongue and nation people for your name. Lord, help us to overcome today by the blood of Christ, which we take here today, and by the word of our testimony as we declare you until the day you come. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, we'll have the servers come up here and serve each other this morning first, and then you're welcome to come and file up here and be served. And as you take this, you declare to all heaven and earth that you belong to Jesus and that he belongs to you.
Do
is all creation groaning.
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is. It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of
it? It is.
Would you please stand and sing with us? Seated.
Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want your name and your person exalted here today. We only want to remember you. We only want to worship you. And so as we come to your word and we read about how you interacted with the forces of darkness in this world, the demonic realm, people, your Father. Lord, we want to learn of you. Because there is a battle and we're in it. And we want to fight it as you fought it. And so we pray, Holy Spirit, empower us today. Like the early church, we wait for you. We wait for your power to fall upon us. Because we know we can do nothing without you. And so that's why we're here today. Because we recognize that we need Christ. We need to abide in him. We need to draw our life and our strength from him right now. And so we do this humbly, Lord, just beseeching you that you will feed us with the bread from heaven. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're in Mark chapter 3, so if you got your Bibles, go ahead and turn there today. That's where we're going to be camping here for a little bit in about 15 verses there. I think I may have told you the story before, so I'll make it brief, but did you ever have a family member or a sibling or a child who was always wandering off? Some of us have had that. Our wanderer, one of them, was David when he was young, and we as a family were back in the East Coast doing a sabbatical at the time, and we happened, shame on me for not knowing my history, but we happened to stumble into Gettysburg during the anniversary of the Gettysburg battle. And of course, every year back there, they do a reenactment. And they have thousands, tens of thousands of people who descend on Gettysburg and in period costume, and they reenact battles and all sorts of things. And this was the 137th anniversary of the battle. And David was 7 years old. And next thing we knew, we turned around, and he was nowhere to be found among thousands of people. And I expected to see him, you know, wandering into the foray of the battle or something. And maybe that's why he's interested in search and rescue right now, because we spent I don't know, half hour combing this place with thousands of people trying to find him. And thankfully, long and short, he had gone across the road and gone back to the RV, where we said, if we somehow get separated, go back to the RV. And he had, and there was, sitting on the steps waiting for us. You know, sometimes families have to go searching for each other, right? Today's passage revolves around one of those experiences of Jesus' family of origin, where they felt it necessary to go searching for him. He was staying in Capernaum by the Sea of Galilee. They were in Nazareth, and yet they got word that they felt he was lost. And so they did the 30-mile trek from Nazareth to Capernaum in order to help him out, help their older brother out, help their son out. I've wondered often what it must have been like for Jesus' half-siblings growing up under the shadow of Mr. Perfect, literally. We're told nothing about what those developmental years were like as a family with siblings and stuff like that. The only window we get into it is when Jesus, went to the temple at age 13, and then his whole family went back. They went back home, and he stayed behind to do his father's business, and of course that just absolutely sent his parents into a panic as they came back to Jerusalem searching for this son of theirs. So even when you raise a perfect kid, it's not easy, right? Just remember that, parents. Your kids are far from perfect, but even Jesus' parents got dragged through a knothole occasionally with his perfection. So we're going to pick it up today where his family is going to help him, they think. And that's in Mark chapter 3 and verse 20. So here we go. Then Jesus entered a house, and again, a crowd gathered. We saw that last week, right? The crowds versus the core. A crowd gathered so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him. For they said, he's out of his mind. And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, he's possessed by Beelzebul, by the prince of demons. He's driving out demons. So Jesus called them over to him, and he began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up, and then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander that they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They're guilty of an eternal sin. He said this because they were saying, well, he has an impure spirit. And then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, your mother and your brothers, they're outside looking for you. Who are my mother and my brothers? He asked. And then he looked at those seated in a circle around him, and he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and my sister and my mother. Okay, so this particular passage, you'll notice, is kind of, it's like a shelf on your a bookshelf that has bookends on both sides. It starts with the story of Jesus' family, his nuclear family, his biological family, and it ends with that. And it sandwiches in between this issue of the religious leaders and their opinion of him. You remember that last week we saw how Jesus had to continually exercise boundaries in his relationship with the crowd so that he had enough to give to the core that he had chosen. And today's story is no different. In fact, the problem had become so challenging that his family was concerned that for his self-preservation. They apparently had gotten word 30 miles away that, hey, he's wasting away. There's so many people pressing in on him. He's not even eating. And so you can imagine what the family discussion was about. Oh, yeah. Oh, Jesus. We got to go help him out. His boundaries are a mess right now. So they leave and make the 30-mile trek. You know, this should be a cautionary tale. Having grown up with the only sinless sibling on the planet, you would think that his brothers would be a little slower to say, we got to go help him out. But they didn't get this. And somehow they pulled mom into the story too. They even got Mary to say, yeah, we need to go help him out, okay? We would be wise to be more gracious and less judgmental with the people God puts us next to in our family, right? They're not perfect, but our opinion of what God may or may not be doing with them is less than perfect as well. So this story begins by Mark letting us know that Jesus' family thought he was losing it. The crowd thing was getting out of hand, so they agreed, let's take charge. Another cautionary tale here. Beware when you think you need to take charge of God. When you need to take charge of things that look like they're out of control, but God is really in control in the moment. How many times do we think our perspective of a situation is the right one and God's is actually wrong? I don't know about you, but I argue with God. I look at some things and I say, really, Lord? What are you doing here? But it would be wiser of me to recognize that my perspective is always limited and his is unlimited. Jesus' family clearly did not recognize that their brother or their son was who he was. And even in the midst of the mess of this world, it's very easy for us not to recognize that God is there. He's doing something. And he doesn't need us to rearrange it. He needs us to submit ourselves to whatever it is that he's doing. Now, let me just address this for just kind of a quick sidebar here. This issue of Jesus' siblings for a moment. The story is bookended, of course, by these actions of the family toward Jesus. And just some of you may have grown up in a tradition that said Jesus didn't have brothers and sisters. Okay, I'm not here to fight against that tradition. But let me just point you to what the scripture says here. The context here, when it speaks about his mother and it speaks about his brothers. Now, brother is a term that's a big term. It's used a lot in the New Testament. And it can refer to everything from your blood siblings to half siblings to spiritual siblings, brothers and sisters in the Lord. So it's got a lot of usage. But every biblical indication in this passage is that these were actually blood-related siblings of Jesus. They would have been half siblings. Mark chapter 6, in fact, names them. It talks about Mary's sons, and then it gives the names of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon. And then it says, and his sisters. The fact that Jesus had other half siblings in no way harms the biblical teaching on the virgin birth, the blessedness of Mary. It doesn't. But Mark wants us to recognize that Jesus lived in a family and it wasn't perfect. And you and I are living in families that aren't perfect, be they biological families, be they church families, be they national families. And he's saying, you got to learn how to function in that setting. And so he's giving us some pictures here. So Mark now moves from the family snapshot of them thinking disparagingly of Jesus to actually judgmental snapshot of religious leaders thinking diabolically about him. There is a difference here. There's a vast difference between saying, something's not right with that guy, and saying, that guy is demonically possessed. Being misunderstood is quite different from being maligned. And Jesus knew the difference here, too. And his family, who simply misunderstood the situation, I think, were met with a rather gentle education. The religious leaders, however, who we know from the previous section, had already determined they wanted to kill Jesus. I mean, they'd made up their mind. Prior rejection here. He brings a stinging rebuke of where they are, and he does it in this text through flawed, he says, I want to point out your flawed logic. Now, I don't think Jesus was trying to argue anybody, especially the religious leaders, to change their mind about rejecting him. I don't think anybody gets argued into heaven. But I do think that God wants us to love him with all of our mind. And so therefore, when the enemy plants a lie, God loves to say, wait a minute, use your mind for a moment here. Let's see if this holds up under stress. Let's see if this lie or this statement is really true. Not to convince somebody who's already decided, I don't want anything to do with God, but to help the people who are still in the decision-making process or have already decided, no, I'm full in with God, but oh, that's a good question. I wonder if I'm mistaken. Okay, we still need to answer those issues. And so, I think Jesus, in this particular case, is responding here with logic to protect those who are still open to the evidence, open to where the facts will lead them, also susceptible to influence by error. God wants us to love him with all of our minds, as well as all of our emotions, our wills, and our actions. So he's at times going to give us some really good logic. And this is one of the times that we're going to see. By the way, you're going to see that on Easter Sunday here as well, about the resurrection. Anyway, the difference Jesus is drawing here is between those who would eventually become his spiritual family and those who were determined not to be his spiritual family. And the same is true today. The argument that Jesus is about to make will make logical sense to anyone genuinely open to the work of God in their lives. And that may be some of you sitting here today. You probably didn't come to church to pick a fight with a pastor. That's my guess, right? You came to church because you want to be either built up in your faith or you're not sure. And you'd like some more information about, is this Jesus the one I should really surrender my life to? So, let's look at the charge that they level against Jesus and how Jesus answered that. In verse 22, here's the charge. He's possessed by Beelzebul, by the prince of demons. He is driving out these demons. Now, just historically, Beelzebub, however your version has it, came from a kind of a compound word, Baal Zebub. It meant lord of Baal, lord of the flies. I don't know why they chose the flies, but anyway, that was the euphemism for Satan, lord of the flies. Now, that was also a 1954, I think it was, a book and later a movie about, you know, some incorrigible boys who were shipwrecked on an island somewhere and what happened to them when there was no parental guidance to speak of, okay? Well, that's kind of humanity, right? This is what happens to humanity when there's no parental guidance over our world. It's Lord of the Flies, trust me. Yeah. Okay, so anyway, so here was the charge. Jesus is demonically inspired. What he does is because Satan is working through him. He's a charlatan and he's a fraud. This was a bold claim, right? Now, as C.S. Lewis argues in Mere Christianity, that is certainly one of the options that is open to you if you reject Jesus for who he claimed to be, God in human flesh. If you say, no, I don't like that option, then your remaining options, as Lewis says, are B, well, he was obviously then a fake and a charlatan. He knew he wasn't God, and he pretended to be God so he could fool everybody. Or C, he was a lunatic, mentally unstable, kind of like his family was thinking at the moment, mentally unstable, and therefore can be discarded because you don't follow mentally unstable people. That's just not a wise thing to do. So he has the liar, lunatic, or Lord. Well, his family had chosen lunatic for the moment. The opposition had chosen liar, prince of liars, for the moment. And Jesus said, okay, you got a decision to make here. You make your choice because it has eternal implications. So now let's look at the simple logic that Jesus goes through. There are three premises that he puts out here. Premise number one, you cannot destroy yourself and survive. Pretty self-evident, right? I mean, it would seem, it is. It's obvious. Jesus makes the argument here. How can Satan drive out Satan? If Satan opposes himself, he cannot stand. His end has come. Well, clearly, Satan's end has not come yet, right? And it had not come in Jesus' day. So he's saying, that logic is really flawed because if Satan is fighting against himself, he will self-destruct. It's like asking, how can I drive myself out? Well, the only way to get rid of me is to commit suicide, right? That's the ultimate self-destruction. Because while I'm alive, where I am, there I go. I can't get away from myself. This is why people who say, well, I need a new spouse, or I need a new job, or I need a new church. I just look at them and say, where you go, there you are. Because the issue is not usually the other person. The issue is who you're taking with you wherever you're going. It's you. It's you. And Jesus is saying, you know, if Satan's fighting against himself, he's committing suicide. And obviously, look around, he's not. There's plenty of evil happening. This is sobering truth. Even Satan recognizes that he cannot war against himself and survive. So he doesn't. It's only humans in all of creation who war against ourselves, right? I looked this up this last week. Do animals commit suicide? There is zero evidence that any other animal on this planet seeks to self-destruct themselves because they hate themselves. They may self-destruct to protect the colony. They may self-destruct for any number of, but not because they hate themselves. Humans are unique in this. We beat ourselves up over just about anything. We criticize ourselves. We speak against ourselves in our minds. We say things to and about ourselves that God would never say about us. And God weeps. And Satan cheers. Those who love us, they grieve when they see this. We don't feel better. We don't get better. But too often we keep trying to drive ourselves out of our own habitation. And taken to the extreme, we destroy ourselves. And you see it everywhere in our culture right now. I remember mowing the lawn one day when the kids were small, and I don't know what the issue was. I was feeling pretty low, and I was really frustrated, and I was angry at myself. And I'm going back and forth on the lawn, and I'm just working out the frustration on the lawn. And God just said to me, John, how do you feel about your kids? And I said, oh, man, I love my kids. Are they perfect? Oh, no. But how do you feel about them? I love them. And he says, do you think you're a better father than I am? I said, No, I'm not. Then how do you think I feel towards you? I think God wants to say to some of us today, stop trying to destroy yourself. Stop speaking lies to yourself. Let me love you as the perfect father that I am. Don't do to yourself what Satan won't even do to himself. Let me bring wholeness and harmony to your soul. I can reconstruct what you're so self-disappointed in. But you got to let me do it. So there's the first logical argument he's using against this thing. Second premise. Divided self-warring kingdoms or countries or nations will self-destruct. He says, if a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. Show me a nation that is in perpetual civil war, and I'll show you an absolutely destroyed country. When I was in seminary, one of my professors had consulted for 30 years in Africa. And of all the continents in the world, I think Africa is most decimated by war over and over again. And he had consulted at that time in Sudan, which had just finished up about 18 years of civil war that had cost them 2 million lives and about 4 million displaced people in Sudan. You know what's happened to Sudan since then? It's had another 23 years of civil war. It's had another couple of million people killed. It's had 10 million people displaced. It's not thriving as a country. It has had more coups and more years of civil war in the last century than any other country in Africa. And it's paying the price. Just look at Haiti, right? It will not survive. People are dying in the streets. Our most costly war was our civil war, of course, 655,000 casualties. And we're hurtling towards another one right now. We need to work as God's people to bridge this gulf that is going to self-destruct our country. That's why, I'll tell you right now, I'm investing, spending time with people I don't normally like to hang out with. People who are more liberal than me theologically, more liberal than me politically. People who have characteristics that I don't necessarily cozy up to. Because when the day comes when people start killing each other in our streets, I don't want to be a part of that. I want to be standing next to my neighbor defending their lives, even though I disagree vehemently with a lot of things they stand for. A nation will fall that fights against itself. And you and I, folks, we have got to reject this agenda that Satan's got for our country right now. He wants us hating each other. And the people of God have got to say, nope, not on my watch. Nope. I'm gonna prove my love for my liberal neighbor. I'm gonna prove my love for my Wiccan neighbor. His last appeal, Jesus' last logical appeal here, is in verse 25. It's premise number 3. Households that don't work together will also fall apart. If a house is divided against itself, the house cannot stand. The word for house here is oikos, or it's a broad term as well. It means not only literal house, where you're living in a building, but it means the household, the people in the house as well. And I think in this particular context, it's really speaking to the household. God is not so vitally concerned that all four walls of your house stay standing forever, but he is concerned that your family stands forever in heaven. And so that's the household, I think, that he's speaking to here. Again, this is a self-evident truth. Families either learn to work together or they fail. Husbands and wives either work for each other and the good of their marriages, or they work against each other and they lose their marriage. And when that happens, everybody suffers. Children, they suffer. The adults suffer. The neighbors suffer. The community suffers. I've been reading a book recently called The Toxic War on Masculinity. It's subtitled How Christianity Reconciles the Sexes. Ever wonder why God put so two different people, male and female, together for a lifetime in a thing called marriage? Because it demands the presence of God to work well. Let me just tell you about one of the recent studies about Christian marriages. It's good news. There's been a fair amount of press, some of it not true at all, about how abusive and damaging and destructive traditional Christian marriages can be to families. The problem is that the critics are not doing a deep dive into the data to separate people who just say they're Christians and people who actually are Christians. They live the life out. So social science empirical studies show that men who identify as theologically conservative Christians, in other words, they believe that we are in a complementary theological relationship with our spouses, they also believe in male headship, they also believe in disciplining their children, those people who call themselves Christian divide into two groups: those who actually practice that theology and those who just say they do. Let me give you an example. Those who attend church at least 3 times a month shatter the negative stereotypes about Christian white males or whatever race they are. The facts are, and this is according to their wives, they are more loving and more emotionally engaged with their children than any group of men in our country. Any group. They are the least likely to divorce, and they have the lowest levels of domestic abuse and violence. However, nominally committed Christian men who just say, well, I'm a Christian, you know, I grew up Baptist or whatever, I really don't practice my faith. I don't pray daily. I certainly don't pray with my wife. I don't go to church very often, but I'm a Christian. These men sadly spend less time with their children either in discipline or shared activities. Their wives report significantly lower levels of happiness. Their marriages are far less stable, whereas active evangelical men are 35% less likely to divorce than secular men. Nominal Christian men are 20% more likely to divorce than the culture. And yet they lump them all together and see, you Christian guys, you're, no. I would say the nominal Christian is not a Christian at all, because he's not walking according to what Christ said. He said, you're my brother and sister if you obey, if you do what I say, not think about it. But the men who do it, guys, we're the envy of the rest of the world. Our marriages are happier. Our children are happier. All across the board, they're just great stuff. So, Jesus chose the individual, the nation, and the family to prove his point that, hey, what I'm doing cannot be done if I'm energized by Satan. Either you have to face the fact that what I'm doing is by the power of God and in the power of God, or you got to call me a devil. There's no middle ground here. There's no middle ground. Now, having shown them the error of his their reasoning, Jesus now points to the truth of what he has been doing and, more importantly, who he is. In verse 27, he says, Jesus calls them here to recognize who he is. He says, in fact, no one can enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can rob his house. Jesus, when he delivered demon-possessed people from demonic oppression, he was the one tying up the strong man. Okay? So he was tying up Satan, and he's saying, the logic that you just gave me, that I'm doing this by the power of Satan, I hope I just dismantled that. So what you're left with is, I'm stronger than Satan. And who in this universe is stronger than Satan? Only God. Now, he could have said, God, and God could do this because he does it with us. He delegates to us his authority and his power, and he says, you go ahead and you take authority over that demonic realm. So he could delegate it without being God in human flesh, right? But his argument here is, and this is one of the reasons I think why there was so much demonic expression during the life of Christ. It's because God was inhabiting the planet, and it was a sharp contrast between light and darkness, between God and demons, okay? And that passage we read in Revelation earlier this morning is about how Satan wanted to destroy Jesus. He went after the woman, you know, to destroy her offspring, and God snatched him up to heaven. A resurrection? And now Satan is really ticked off. So, you see what Jesus is pressing us to? He drops the hammer in verse 28. Truly I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander that they utter. That's good news, right? But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin. In my understanding, there is only one sin in Scripture that God will not forgive, and that is a rejection of Him. That is a rejection of the person of Christ. That is a rejection of the demonstration of the Holy Spirit through Christ. God will forgive us of everything else. Everything else. But that is that one sin of saying, no, you look like the devil to me, and I don't want that. That's a sin God says, I'm sorry, I can't forgive you that. It's an eternal sin. It's an eternal sin. That is not God's heart for you or for me. And I would just appeal you to today, if you're listening and you've been on the fence, and you're wondering, what do I do with Jesus? You got to go one way or the other. He's not going to let you sit in the middle because he loves you too much. He's not going to let you say, well, yeah, Jesus is a good person, but I don't have to deal with him. No, he's going to say, no, call me a demon or call me Lord. You got to choose. But know that your choice has eternal implications. Oh, it'll change your life temporally too. We know that, don't we? So many of us sitting here, we've been rescued from sin. We've been rescued from the dominion of the evil one. But know that if you say no to God, you're choosing Satan as your Lord. There's no middle ground. So I appeal to you. Why won't you believe today? Why won't you come running to the one who gave his life for you rather than the one who wants to destroy you? Call out by faith. Cry out to him. There are no magic words. He sees your heart. You just say, Lord, I desperately need you. Verse 35, Jesus ends it up. He says, whoever does God's will is my brother and my sister and my mother. God's will is that nobody should perish. How about you do God's will? Not self-destruct. God's will is that you and I would be set apart, sanctified in Christ to be his holy family. How about we come running to him? God's will is that you believe in Jesus so that believing you can have life forever. Mark ends this section where he started with the blood relatives of Jesus, but he throws the net so much wider in that simple statement. Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you, and he says, no, 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 they're right here inside. It's you guys. It's you who have decided to follow me. You got a hunger for actually doing God's will? That's a great evidence that you're part of the family. Jesus delights to call you his sister, his mother, his brother. Maybe you're feeling the influence of the strong man in your life right now. And Jesus is just saying, hey, let me take charge. Let me lay waste to him instead of him laying waste to you. Cry out to me, and I will give you rest. Let's pray. Jesus, we worship you this morning, maker of heaven and earth. You knit us together, cell by cell in our mother's womb. Oh, re-knit us, we pray. Re-knit us together in Christ. Be it as families, be it as marriages, be it as a nation, be it as a church. Lord, we will not survive if we fight against ourselves and each other. So we call to you. We look to you, Christ, today. Become our everything. Become our very life. For we long to know you as you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, would you stand, and we're just going to worship the Lord. That's the best thing we could do to end a service, is focus on Christ. If you've said yes to Jesus today, would you please tell somebody you know can help you grow about that decision and let them know? Prayer counselors are going to be right here. Please come up and pray with them. And if there's anything that you want prayer for, that's what this is about. That's why we come together, to be in the presence of the Lord. Andrew.
Christ the Lord, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground.
light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, sin has lost its grip on me, for I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ.
No guilt in life,
blessed week. Go in peace.